A pastor shares his long-kept secret.
13, I was sexually abused. I had so many emotions. Literally, is this okay? Is this right? Should this be happening?
And discovers the power of confession.
You've got to open up and tell someone.
On today's 700 Club Interactive. Well, welcome to the show. Can you remember the last time you were shocked by what your pastor said? Well, members of People's Church in Oklahoma City can. One Sunday, megachurch pastor Herbert Cooper made a stunning confession, revealing a past secret that only a few people knew.
Herbert Cooper grew up in a small town, the kind of town where people don't lock their doors and everyone knows your name. But the damage done to Herbert wasn't caused by a stranger. She was a family friend.
I think I could have went to my grave with just covering it up, that nobody would know what I had experienced. I grew up in a small town called Weewoka, Oklahoma, a town about 4,000 to 5,000 people where everybody knew each other. At the age of 13, I was sexually abused, molested by a lady for several months. It was someone that our family knew, and she took advantage of me. I actually lost my virginity. I had so many emotions. Literally, is this okay? Is this right? Should this be happening? Why is it happening? Because obviously, I ended up in a place going, this is totally wrong and painful, and I do not want to continue down this road. And I'll never forget one day simply telling the lady, leave me alone, leave me alone. She actually threatened me, said, I'm gonna tell your parents. I just knew I didn't want to continue. I didn't want this to continue to happen in my life. And so I literally just told her no, shoved the door, fell back on the bed in tears and cried. The abuse ended. Even though it happened to me, It was just shame. There was guilt. I worked really hard to be the cool guy. I threw myself totally into sports to cover up all the pain. I lived, I ate, I breathed football. Just kind of built my world around playing football. And I remember that there was a Fellowship of Christian Athletes meeting at the Weewoka football locker room. I didn't really care about God, didn't care about Jesus, didn't care about church. But I heard they had free pizza. And the former kicker for the Oklahoma Sooners, Todd Thompson, was the speaker that night. And he just simply shared the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news, the hope that was in Christ, that he loved us, that he would forgive us of our sins. And then there was hope through Christ. My heart softened. And that night, I gave my heart to Christ. Tears streamed down my face. I literally cried like a baby, surrendering my life to Jesus Christ. And I literally walked out of that football locker room a different person. My entire priority shifted. My life was no longer wrapped up in football and chasing girls. It was now wrapped up in knowing Jesus Christ, living for Him. I ended up playing football on a football scholarship at Evangel University, but it wasn't a driving force in my life. Jesus became that for me. I graduated with a Bible degree and a minor in psychology, and nobody knows. I was broken, I was hurting, because I was abused, sexually abused at the age of 13. And I'm now engaged to my wife, Tiffany. It's just going through my mind, you gotta tell Tiffany. You have to tell Tiffany. And I'm literally fighting, thinking I do not want her to know. And what if I tell her and the engagement's off? What if I tell her and she doesn't want to marry me? What if I tell her and she doesn't accept me? And it was at that moment I said, I can't go into a marriage covenant without the person I'm going to spend the rest of my life with not knowing a huge part of what has shaped me or what caused me to feel or have lack of trust. And so, and that night in the car, I just let Tiffany know. I said, I was sexually abused. She asked a couple of questions and I wasn't ready. You know, I wasn't ready to go all into the story and what happened. And she just left it there. And she was okay with me opening up with her, knowing she was the first person to ever know. It could sound so simple, but it was a huge hurdle. I mean, when you've kept a secret, when nobody's known, and now you're actually opening up, it was jumping over a huge barrier. We got married at the age of 22 and 20, and I traveled full-time as an evangelist for 6 or 7 years. And then my wife and I moved to Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, and started a church called People's Church. And then I ended up talking to a small group of men about the abuse. These two guys accepted me and still loved me and still respected me as their pastor. It built confidence in me. The scripture says, confess your faults to one another so that you can be healed. And so there is really healing. It's therapeutic to confessing. And I think for me, the biggest hurdle when I really felt like it went from a wound to a scar is when I said, I can tell the church. At that point, I knew I've been healed and I'm whole. I've forgiven. And the lady has called me a couple of occasions. One time I took the call. I talked to her on the phone. I was very kind. I was very cordial. I'm not angry or mad. And so I'm able to forgive, because scripture actually says if you don't forgive those who hurt you, then your Heavenly Father won't forgive you. And so this is something that's between you and God, to say, God, I'm going to forgive. And it can be a process, but as you journey through it, God really helps you to forgive and to let go. Statistics are high. One in every four girls and one in every six boys by the age of 18 will be abused. I would say realize that it is a journey and you've got to have Christ at the center of it. There's healing in the Word of God. There's healing by being in church and hearing the Word. Pursue God. I would say get a group of people that you can talk to. I think one of the worst things that happens to people like myself that have been abused is to keep it to yourself. Don't let the shame, don't let the guilt, don't let the mind games, don't let the enemy of your soul play games with you and make you feel like nobody can know. Nobody can know. You've got to open up and tell someone. And then with the anger and the bitterness, I would say as you seek God, as you open your heart up, as you're in the scriptures, as you talk to a small group of people who love Jesus, those feelings will continue to go away as the Holy Spirit continues to soften your heart and pour His joy and His healing power in. I'm a living testimony of that.
And you can be a living testimony of it too, where your wound can no longer be active. It no longer hurts. It'll still be there. It'll be a scar, but it's not going to hurt you anymore. You're still going to have the memory, but you're going to be past it because it no longer wounds you. How do you get that? How does that happen? Well, you hear it in what Herbert did. He first said, I'm going to tell somebody. I'm getting ready to get into a marriage covenant. And he was obviously taking that very seriously. And he said, I have to tell her. I have to let her know what she's getting into, what's happened to me, how I've been shaped, what's gone wrong. And he did. And in that, he found, well, he wasn't really ready to get into the details. She asked a couple of questions, but it was a big hurdle for him. And you saw the light in his eye that he finally had made it. He finally came out what had happened. And the wonderful thing is he was accepted. And then he took it a step further. I'm going to tell some men about it that I'm in relationship with. And I'm gonna let it out there. And then for him, the big thing was to say, I'm going to do it in front of my entire church. I'm gonna let everybody know what happened to me. Now, there are issues here, particularly with how do you want to be perceived going forward. But the problem with that thought process is that the more you think about that, the less you are likely to let somebody else in and to let somebody else minister to that hurt so it's no longer a wound, but it becomes a scar. And each case will be different as to how much you trust, how much you're willing to let someone else in to say, here's my problem. But the Bible is very specific. If we confess our sins to one another, that's the key. And I'm a big believer in confession. You don't have to do it publicly. You don't have to stand up in church and let everybody know. But there is a time of getting that out so you're not the only one. Because when you're the only one, that's when that wound's allowed to fester. when you have that thought process of people really know me, they really know what I've done or what has been done to me, then you won't be able to find that forgiveness, that freedom of really knowing that you can be free from it. The wonderful thing is once you're through it, once you're over that hurdle, just like Herbert, you'll find that these sins are common. You know, we want to hide in guilt and shame, not realizing it's that guilt and shame that keeps us as a prisoner. And when you come out of that to the other side, Herbert found, well, 1 in 4 women in America today have gone through abuse. 1 in 6 boys. Those are big numbers. Those aren't little numbers. Those are big numbers. And you don't have to have it chase you. You don't have to have it continually wounding you. You can get free. But do it in a way where that first time you do it, you're with someone you absolutely trust. You know that they're not going to say anything to anybody else. They're just there to love you and accept you for who you are. And once you're through that first hurdle, then it'll get easier. And then that wound, it won't affect you anymore. It's not going to hurt you anymore. And my hope for you is that you'll find forgiveness. Forgiveness for yourself, forgiveness especially for the other person, because that sets you free. The more you have that anger, the more you're wounding yourself. They're not even there anymore. They're not even in your life anymore. But there's still, that's still that wound from the memory. You can be free from all of that. Now, if you want a safe place where you can confess, we're here for you. We're not here to judge you. We're certainly not here to condemn you. We're here to tell you God loves you and He can make you free. He can set you free from this. So if you want to do this anonymously, you don't need to give us your name, anything. All you have to do is pick up a phone and call. Number's on the screen, 888-777-1999. Just reach out and let someone to let them know. I believe in confession. And when you confess your sins to one another, you can be free. Well, if you're a fan of the game Angry Birds, we can promise you won't look at the game the same way after watching this. Here's Herbert Cooper with what Angry Birds can teach us about forgiveness.
The game Angry Birds is rather interesting. The premise of the game is the birds are angry at the pigs because the pigs have stolen their eggs. And so the bird, they fly into bricks and walls and steel to try to destroy the pigs to get back their eggs. But when they fly into the buildings fall on top of them and the birds end up dying themselves. And it's interesting because the game Angry Birds, after the birds finish one level, the game just goes to the next level. And that's a lot like life, because we get hurt and wounded and battered and disappointed in life. And we can respond like Angry Birds. And we try to retaliate and get even and hurt the people who have hurt us. And we end up just going to another level of bitterness and anger and rage and hostility. And yes, it's true, we may hurt others, we may get even with others, we may retaliate, but we only end up hurting ourselves. That's why the scripture says in Matthew 6 and verse 14, Jesus tells us, people who are angry birds, if we forgive those who sin against us, our Heavenly Father will forgive us. But if we don't forgive those who sin against us, our Heavenly Father won't forgive us. See, when we forgive, when we're not angry birds, when we forgive others, God moves our direction with His healing power, with His grace, with His presence. It's true, we're hurt, we're wounded, we try to retaliate. But when we forgive, it creates but God moments. We're wounded, but God heals us.
An amazing lesson to be taken from a game, but a game with a message behind it today. And it's a message for all of us. Be free. You know, as Gordon talked before and as Herbert was just talking, I think of that scripture that says, we're called out of the darkness into his marvelous light. What a great opportunity to be set free today. Well, up next, a cheating husband gets busted by his own wife. Watch what happens when she finds out. Stay with us. Mitch Alverson didn't wait long to succumb to the seven-year itch. Shortly after marrying Michelle, Mitch was checking out internet porn. And after the years of lies, he was left with one final option. So Mitch packed his bags and told the truth.
Michelle caught her husband Mitch red-handed. She was going through bills when she saw charges for internet pornography. She told herself it wasn't a big deal the first time.
It was a guy thing. It was just something that men did. And I just said, you know, don't do it anymore. I was gonna ask him on a monthly basis if he had looked at anything to kind of hold him accountable.
It would be something that I would confess more than once.
Mitch was just a curious seven-year-old when he first opened a pornographic magazine, left behind by his big brother. One glance started a habit that stayed.
It became a part of my everyday life.
Mitch couldn't just stop. He was addicted to pornography. And as the confessions kept coming, Michelle's feelings changed.
And then I think I just thought, I don't want to know. You start to think, am I not good enough? It's just betrayal. It's heartbreaking.
Michelle was already a Christian when they married. Soon after, Mitch became a believer too. But the couple was more concerned with how they looked to others and didn't really surrender their lives to God.
I don't know if I knew who I was, really. Scared and lonely and looking for security in a marriage and not in the Lord at all. I did religion. You go to church, you take your kids to Sunday school, and then everything just works out perfect.
I believed in God, but I don't think that He had any rule or reign over my life.
It was all a mask.
The couple was already growing apart when Mitch was asked to work overseas a few months.
I was taking care of the kids, I was taking care of the house, taking care of all the responsibilities here, and actually enjoying it being just us girls.
But Michelle had no idea Mitch was having an affair.
The flesh and the devil had just pulled me away, you know? And I allowed those things to come between me and the Lord and me and my wife.
Mitch's secrets caught up with him when he returned home and noticed symptoms of a sexually transmitted disease.
You need to hit some sort of bottom before you understand the real ramifications of what's going on in your life.
Turns out Mitch didn't have an STD, but the situation was enough to scare him straight. He told Michelle they had to talk.
One way I describe it is if God reached down and kind of grabbed me by the back of the neck and said, I've had enough.
I could hear him crying. I just asked him, I just said, are you having an affair? And he said, yes. Immediately, my heart sunk into my stomach.
I think I had expected her to ask me to leave, and I had intentionally left some things in the car just in case.
The confession from her husband was devastating, but Michelle says the Holy Spirit took over. And even she was shocked by what she did next.
I just began to embrace him and to love on him and to tell him that I would be there for him. And it's a picture of what Jesus did for me. I make my own selfish choices. And he does not turn his face from me. He embraces me and loves me. And that is what I did for Mitch. And in the midst of that, I was comforted as well.
Mitch says his wife's response showed him what God's love really looks like.
He's the one who put me back together. You know, he's the one who reached down and grabbed me and pulled me out. He's made me whole again through Jesus.
Mitch and Michelle made friends at a local church. That's where they joined the Celebrate Recovery Ministry, a Bible-based program that helps people overcome hurt, habits, and addiction.
It takes some accountability, and it takes an open, place where you feel like you can actually share what's going on in your heart.
The couple decided to put God first and let Him show them how to love each other.
We love because He first loved us. So I don't love Mitch
just because he's my husband. I love Mitch because Jesus loves me.
He paid such a high cost for me. I need to love Jesus more than I love that sin.
The one that the Son sets free is free indeed. Mitch said he found wholeness through Jesus Christ, that God used the sacrifice of Christ, the love of Christ, exhibited through his wife, to touch his heart and to change him, to show him what it means to be loved unconditionally. Boy, that's something that's hard to find in the world today, isn't it? If you're struggling, like Mitch was, with some hidden scenario in your life, something that's sunk its teeth into you and you feel like you can't get free from it, you know, the fear of coming out into the marvelous light of God's love keeps us in bondage. Today, you can get past that. We have a toll-free number for you to call. You don't even have to give your name if you don't want to. But there's someone on the other end of that line that's going to answer when you call, who's already found that freedom that you're longing for. You can have it too. It's free for the asking. But you need to ask. You need to come humbly before the Lord and say, God, here I am. Here I am in all the mess that I've made, the sin that I've participated in. I need you. That's why Jesus came. So call now. It's 1-888-777-1999. And just say, will you pray with me? Will you pray with me? There's someone waiting to take your call right now. Call. Gordon?
Well, still ahead, a little boy found it too painful to even play until you got this Cape Crusader on his feet again. That's up next. Imagine your child needs an operation that costs $1,000. You have no insurance and no way of coming up with the money. Well, that was the crisis facing the father in our next story, until he got help from people like you.
4-year-old Rafi was an active boy who loved playing superhero with his dad. But lately, Lamadan has been worried because his little superhero has been sidelined with a painful hernia.
When we found the lump, I was crushed. I couldn't imagine how painful it was for Rafi.
He hasn't been able to sleep. He was vomiting because of the pain. In the past, the lump would come and go. But now, it's there all the time.
Lamadan works as a driver at a factory, earning about $100 a month. Rafi's operation to repair the hernia cost about 10 times that amount.
I was shocked. Of course, we didn't have money for an operation.
Then one day, the couple registered Rafi for a free operation, sponsored by CBN. A surgeon repaired the hernia, and Rafi soon recovered. Within a week, there was no more pain, and the young superhero was back playing with his dad.
Thank you for helping my son. He is so much better now.
Thank you for the surgery, and even for providing meals for us when we were at the hospital. You have done a great thing for us.
You have done a great thing for us. You can be a part of doing great things for people, helping people around the world. How do you do that? Well, just join the 700 Club. It's easy. All you have to do is call us, 888-777-1999, or you can log on to 700clubinteractive.com. Well, we asked if any of you were struggling with forgiving someone, and hundreds have responded. So let's go over to Jessica.
Well, Gordon, that's right. And even though we can't read them all on the show, just know that we are praying for each prayer request we receive. And here's one from Donna. She writes, I'm not sure how to forgive my stepfather for the abuse I suffered as a child at his hands. How do I let go of that? I know I need to forgive him so Jesus can forgive me, but it's difficult. I'm nearly 60 years old and he passed away 20 some years ago. Gordon?
Well, Donna, my heart goes out to you, and I know sometimes it's real difficult to forgive, and it seems to be especially difficult for things that happen when we're a child, and you start wondering, what did I do, or what could I do differently, and all of those things just get you twisted up in knots over it. Here's what I would encourage you to do. Go to Jesus and ask him to help you to forgive. And you can be honest with him and say, this is impossible for me. I can't do it. But with you, all things are possible. Help me to forgive this man. Now, here's a Bible verse for you. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. So let him have that. He claims it. He says, this is me. Let him have that. And then ask him for the forgiveness. And then realize Jesus was able to forgive even from a cross. He forgave the Roman soldiers. And he said, for they know not what they do. And when you realize your stepfather knew not what he did, he had no idea the ramifications, how it would impact you for decades. Get that thought in your mind. Get that vengeance is the Lord's. God's going to repay. And then ask him to give you the ability to forgive. Let's go back over for one more question.
But Gordon, we have a prayer question from Kobe. He says, please pray for me. I can't forgive my mother for choosing meth over my brother and me at the age of 4 and 2.
Kobe, I want to help you with that one. We're running out of time, but realize she didn't choose. Meth took over her brain. It wasn't a choice on her part. Meth was doing the choosing, not your mother. We leave you this word from James. Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. God bless you. We'll see you again.